I first met Nina Jacobson sometime in the mid-90s when I was asked to join a group she was forming called Out There. This was not a group for astronauts or weirdos. Rather, it was a very small gathering of out people in Hollywood. I think we started with like 10 people. The purpose at that time was clear and strong: be out and proud and encourage like-minded folks to create gay characters and discuss gay issues. Now, this seems very vanilla now, but back then, 25 years ago, in Hollywood, being gay was something you could actually be fired for. And one of my first agents that year was indeed fired for being out of the closet. And his heartbreaking response upon hearing the news was, quote, "I knew I should not have driven my red Volkswagen Cabriolet to work." He also complained about an asparagus fern that he had in his office, but he thought they gave him away. But the specter of HIV/AIDS and that discrimination was at that time still heavily in the air as well. Many of us were a little reluctant and afraid to be who we were, but never Nina. And that is one of the things I most admire about her. She has always been 100% unconditionally herself, a quiet, elegant pathfinder who tolerates no bullshit and always makes everyone in her atmosphere rise to be the very best person that they can be. For two decades now, Nina has inspired so many of us not to be comfortable with just being gay, but rather being comfortable being human. She doesn't like labels. She has always stood for equality. I remember when I first met Nina and she was at DreamWorks working with Steven Spielberg, and I thought quietly to myself, this person is so calming and so thought-provoking, she should leave Hollywood and run for president, and I still feel this way about her today. She'll never do it. To me, the word visibility means more than just being authentic. It means much more. For ones, it means walking the walk, and Nina has done that in her personal life with her wife, Jen. They have been together for 25 years, which deserves applause in this room. Married since 2008, and they have three beautiful children. The thing I don't think Nina knows about her badass, visible self is how many babies she has inspired and helped create, perhaps more than D'Angelo and a couple glasses of red wine. Nina and Jen were the first gay couple I knew who were having children. For many of us, this was never a dream. It was an impossibility. I have two young children now, and I remember my very first glimmer that they could exist actually was through Nina and her parental leadership. "You can and should have a family," I remember her saying. Here's how we did it, which is not how you're gonna do it, but that's not the point. The point is to just do it and love and spread love as much as you can in this world. I think a lot of gay people who looked up to Nina got this advice, and tonight I wanted to use this occasion to thank her for expanding my life in such a great way and that of so many others. And I really do believe that you can't become what you can't see. Nina has also been a pathfinder on the creative side. She is, to my knowledge, the first out gay studio head and pioneered a slew of brilliant, lucrative films during her run at Disney, including The Pirates of the Caribbean and The Princess Diaries. Gay favorites all. My favorite thing about Nina during this period is that she never once bought a pitch from me, despite at least a dozen attempts, and although at the time I was furious. I am now relieved because she saved the world from so many shitty, awful romantic comedies. So, Nina, thank you for that. Now, Nina is a powerful producer with her incredibly brilliant producing partner, Brad Simpson. And I think what Nina and Brad are doing with story and character at their company, Color Force, is as equally powerful and stirring as anything Nina has accomplished. We are currently working together on a TV show called The People versus O.J. Simpson. I begged for this job, and I was lucky that they hired me. And my first glimpse of how Nina is today changing the world happened when we were working on an episode that aired 2 weeks ago called Marsha, 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 that I directed. And this is an episode that is about feminism, it's about working mothers, and about how the system isn't kind to women or gay people or really any minorities. Nina worked so hard on that script and she had such a clear point of view. I'm sure injecting her own experiences into the narrative, because Nina is a woman who, I kid you not, was let go from one odious job in the middle of having a baby in the hospital, which I think she might talk about tonight. But this is what Nina does. She takes characters and archetypes we think we know, and she uses them to illuminate the human spirit, or in the case of Marcia Clark, help rehabilitate her public image entirely. She did it with Marcia, and she did it with Katniss during her incredibly powerful and lucrative The Hunger Games film series that she produced starring Jennifer Lawrence. That combined, these three films have grossed an incredible $2.4 billion worldwide. I am so happy and proud that Nina is a producer now and in control of her own destiny. We have years, if not decades, of characters in front of us from her that will illuminate our struggles, give hope to the weary, and push us towards a positive, if not easy, resolve, just like Nina has always done in her life. This year in my company, I created a foundation called HALF. And the goal of that foundation is very simple. From this year on, 50% of all the directorial slots on TV shows that I produce will be filled by women, and 50% will be filled by minority and LGBTQ individuals. And I formed this foundation for two reasons. One, I think our industry is in crisis, and I think we need equal representation for all types of storytelling. And two, I was really being selfish. In forming HALF, I was honestly just trying to find the next Nina, a person who has meant so much to me over the years and to the world at large. So before we bring her to the stage, I invite you to take a look at the screens while we showcase some of Nina's work.
You know, people think princesses are supposed to wear tiaras, marry the prince, always look pretty, and live happily ever after. But it's so much more than that.
We have to help them.
We will, dear one, but not alone.
And the world tells us that they don't want us to be together. We fall apart like we ain't a damn bit of nothing, man.
You're a family. You might just try acting like one.
I really do want to understand, Anna.
I volunteer as tribute.
We wanted to protect you.
If she's not mad and she's not lying, then logically, we must assume she's telling the truth.
Now, I may be a mean cuss, but I'm the same mean cuss with everybody out there on that football field.
I come to win.
How far are you willing to go to save her?
And when you get knocked down, I need you to pop right back up like you know you can.
Do you think she can do it?
Oh, I have no doubt.
I thought so too.
I see dead people.
You know, if I'm gonna die, I wanna still be me.
I have a message for President Snow. You can torture us, and bomb us, and burn our districts to the ground. But do you see that? Fire is catching. And if we burn, you burn with us.
Katniss Everdeen, she's a timeless character, but who has also found her audience at the perfect time. We live in challenging times, and this is a character who manages to do the right thing.
The fact that she could be a hero without ever aspiring to be a hero, and that you don't have to want to be a hero to become one, and you don't have to think like a hero to be one, and even along the ways you might make some mistakes, quite a few mistakes, but if you ultimately make ethical choices, you might end up changing things. I feel enormous gratitude, honestly, to have had the chance to be involved with these books, which are personal, they're political, and they're popular. When does that happen, that something manages to sort of fire on all cylinders of everything that matters to you, but then it also matters to a bunch of other people too?
It's just amazing to have an experience where the thing you love is loved by so many other people.
Nina Jacobson says she wants to use the power she has right now to make stories that mean something and can even change people's minds.
Why wouldn't
a movie or a television show be made up of a population that reflects our own in terms of both race and gender. The notion of celebrity is changing. There's a desire people have for their own participation. I think it's another reason why television has become, in its own way, a communal experience, because you can tweet while you're watching, which you don't do in a movie, and have your own things to say about it. We all have to do something, and I am happy to talk about it until I'm blue in the face, and we'll keep talking about it until it changes.
I am ambitious, I'm driven, but I'm not very kind of conniving. Like, I don't have really a whole lot of ideas on how I'm gonna get ahead. I just know that I want to, but I definitely have sort of strong feelings about what I would or wouldn't do to get there. I went on a business trip with one of my like senior colleagues. We went out for drinks, and I finally worked up the nerve to say, do you think anybody at the office, the bosses, had figured out that I'm not straight? And he said, oh, Nina, I think you can safely assume everyone knows. And it was incredibly liberating to find out that I actually was out. I just didn't know that I was out. Figuring out the balancing act and when you want to put on the gas and when you want to put on the brakes. A woman may just drive differently than a man. She's taking a different route.
There are a lot of ups and downs. There's a lot of uncertainty. It's a really unpredictable profession, and you have to not let failure define you.
Be ambitious for your whole life and not just about your career. My advice to anybody is to be candid, to be kind, to be compassionate, to have a point of view. You have something worthwhile to say.
This girl is on fire.
Please welcome a woman who really has helped change the world, my friend Nina Jacobson.
Anxiety that has gone into this moment, and I'll give my speech, but you have no idea the anxiety involved. Okay, thank you very much. That was incredibly kind, Ryan, and all of you. I'm very grateful. When Tammy Billick called to tell me that HRC wanted to honor me with the Visibility Award tonight, my first impulse was to try to wiggle out of it. I felt hugely honored to be recognized by an organization that has been on the front line in the fight for LGBT rights for over 35 years. Why, besides not knowing what to wear, having to get my highlights done, it's very time consuming, and fear of public speaking, really one of my least favorite things to do, did I hesitate? Well, to be honest, I felt a little unworthy for accepting an award for living a life that I'm fortunate to have. I fell in love with my wife, Jen, 26 years ago. There was a small cajoling period because she had previously been straight. So there was a little cajoling period involved, but anyhow, we've created a wonderful home together with our kids, Noah, Josie, and William. Jen's support, as well as her devotion to our kids, have made it possible for me to thrive in a profession that I love. My mom was here tonight, and my dad, who I lost a few years ago, always wanted me to find happiness, even when it looked different from what they imagined it might be. I know that I am lucky. We are here tonight because there are countless LGBT people who still fear for their lives and livelihoods. For them, being out is an enormous act of courage and strength. But for someone like me, it doesn't feel like nearly enough. When I came out in the late 80s, it felt like a real decision. It also felt important to be visible when I ran the Walt Disney Motion Picture Group. I wanted folks to know that a lesbian mom could shepherd movies for one of the most trusted family brands in the world. I mean, duh, but still, I wanted them to know. My boss would periodically warn me not to be so out that I became known more for being a lesbian than for the movies I made. I wanted to be known for both. By the time 2006 rolled around, I was feeling pretty secure in my outness and my job. Jen was pregnant with our third child, William, and then I got fired over the phone at the hospital while she was in labor. Yep, it is a tough business. But my firing, including the fact that it happened while my partner was giving birth, made the news. I felt extremely visible at that time. In Hollywood, whenever executives get fired, they release a statement saying how excited they are to embark on their lifelong dream of becoming a producer. For me, becoming an independent producer was anything but a dream. I'd built my career as an executive, and I was terrified of going out on my own. I was sure that actually making movies would never be as gratifying as deciding which movies to make. Luckily, it turned out I was wrong about that. I fell in love with producing. Still, without a high-profile executive job, just being visible no longer felt like it packed much of a political punch. Around the same time that I started to hit my stride as a producer, Barack Obama won the Democratic nomination for president. Proposition 8 was on the ballot as well. It seemed impossible that California, a Democratic state that was going to vote in large numbers for our first black president, would outlaw our right to be married. Even so, Jen and I decided, just to be on the safe side, by the way, my mom really wants me to say, she suggested it, and she did, so she's here, she suggested it, that we should get legally married while we still could. We had a small joint ceremony with our friends Angela and Alex, they're here too. We planned to have our actual wedding with our kids, our families, and our friends after Prop 8 was defeated. On election night, when Obama's victory was announced, I felt more hopeful and proud of my country than I ever had. That feeling of immense pride lasted a few short hours. Then the Prop 8 results came in. A wind of change had swept through our country, but it left our family out. I felt both incredibly visible and invisible all at once. I could never have anticipated what the country would look like 8 years later. Obama was not only reelected, he, like many politicians, evolved on gay marriage. The Supreme Court has finally made it the law of the land. Yeah, it's about time, but still, good. And yet the people who feel most visible now are the hordes of angry white people who are seething with bigoted rage. And what is clear is the steps forward we have made, the election of a black president, the legalization of gay marriage, are at the center of this rage. In an election cycle that John Oliver has eloquently termed, holy shit, please make it stop, trash fire, 2015, Donald Trump is on the verge of becoming the Republican nominee. While we may not be a major talking point in the Trump campaign, there's every reason to believe that his followers hate us as much as they hate Mexicans, Muslims, and African Americans. In fact, a recent PPP poll found that a third of Trump voters support banning gays and lesbians from the US. For the record, that poll was taken in South Carolina, but that's really no excuse. Ted Cruz is in second place largely because of his anti-gay rhetoric. So what does it mean to be visible at a time like this, when bigots are the ones coming out of the closet all across the country? We are in a battle now with those committed to inclusion on one side and those railing against it on the other. To be a warrior in this battle, visibility is essential, but it's not enough. Our struggle has always been connected to those of other disenfranchised groups because of the incredible diversity of the LGBT community. All of us outsiders who are under fire can only fight back if we do so on each other's behalf and not just our own.
The forces for inclusion must stand side by side to hold the ground we've won and expand beyond it. This is why I decided to get over my insecurities and accept the award tonight. HRC is uniquely positioned to fight the battles to come. HRC has the reach and influence to stand up to homophobic lawmakers in 32 states with pending anti-LGBT legislation. HRC's corporate index is being used in Hollywood as a template for those of us who want systemic change to make our industry as inclusive as the audiences we need to reach. The CEI singles out corporations that value and respect inclusion and shines a light on those who do not. This kind of accountability will soon be applied not just to Fortune 500 companies, but to film and television productions as well. It is no longer enough for me just to be out and visible in my workplace. I am committed to using my position to make sure the movies and television I produce feature rich, complicated characters who are Black, Hispanic, Asian, Muslim, gay, and trans. And I am committed to making sure the faces behind the camera are just as diverse. I need to use my visibility to make others visible. Ryan Murphy doesn't just talk the talk of inclusion, he walks the walk. Ryan has already brought complex gay characters and issues into millions of living rooms around the world, but he hasn't settled there. As my partner on People vs. O.J. Simpson, Ryan's vision and direction has gotten viewers to feel compassion for characters they previously deplored and start talking about the complexities of race, class, and gender raised by this polarizing case. But he didn't stop there either. Ryan recently announced HALF, a foundation within his company that aims to have 50% of all director slots filled by women, people of color, and members of the LGBT community. That is inclusion. Inclusion is not only a powerful weapon in the war against bigotry, it has also turned out to be a powerful weapon in Hollywood's war against losing money. Empire has proven that Black lives matter in the marketplace as much as they do in cities across America. Transparent has not only advanced trans visibility, but also put Amazon Prime on the map as a top-tier provider of original entertainment. And The Hunger Games has proven that women are every bit as capable as their male counterparts to prevail in the arena of commercial appeal. It's an honor to be recognized for any role I've played in the ongoing struggle for equality. I wouldn't be up here if it weren't for the support and love that I receive daily from my family. More than anyone, my children are the ones who inspire me to make the world they will inherit a more inclusive one. That is what all of us here are fighting for. And though I'm not sure I deserve to stand up here before all of you, I know I can't equivocate or hold back in my commitment to that fight. Because if there was ever a time to be a badass, militant, activist lesbian, it's right now.